Hello and welcome to Prairie Pulse. Thanks for joining us today. Joining me is Gail Asper, a Winnipeg philanthropist and business person. Gail, thanks so much for joining us
today. It's a great pleasure to be here.
As we get started today, and we like to do here, tell the folks a little bit about yourself and your background.
Well, I'm born, bred, and raised in Winnipeg, Manitoba. I spent my life going to school there and went to University of Manitoba to get a law degree. Then I was moved off to Halifax, Nova Scotia, to follow my husband, who was studying freshwater biology at Dalhousie. So we spent 5 years in Halifax, where I practiced my illustrious corporate and commercial law career. Then I was convinced to move back to Winnipeg to join my father, Israel Asper, in his media company, CanWest Global Communications Corp. So I worked with him from 1989 to 2003, 14 years, and live there now. And I've got two beautiful teenage and 21-year-old sons. So I love the city of Winnipeg. I love Manitoba, and I love the prairies.
Okay. Well, and we've been trying to get you on Prairie Pulse for some time, so thanks so much for taking the time to be here today. Primarily, we're here today to talk about the Human Rights Museum, which we'll get to. So, let's just start with that. Tell us about it. It's such a huge project, I would assume.
It is a huge project, and I can tell you that we never started off to build a Canadian Museum for Human Rights. I mean, I'm a corporate and commercial lawyer. That's my training. I don't usually do this sort of thing. But I started working with my father in the Asper Foundation, which was his charitable foundation, and he had a passion for human rights. And he was concerned to see that Canada doesn't do anything like the Americans do to celebrate their human rights heroes. Maybe we'll get into some more history a little bit later, but the idea was to create a place where we can chronicle Canada's human rights journey, warts and all, celebrate our heroes, and also talk about international human rights history, and most importantly, what's going on in the world today in the human rights world, who's doing what to make a difference, and the end result of the museum is to create a sense of responsibility in all the visitors that you too can find a way to have a positive impact in advancing human rights. So this is a $310 million project. And the key thing is, it's Canada's first new national museum in 43 years, and it's the first national museum ever to be established outside of Ottawa. So this was a huge coup to convince the federal government that, yes, not all national museums need to be in Ottawa, just like they don't all have to be in Washington. And we live in countries that are way too big to have everything centralized. We need to bring those jobs and that excitement across the land. And what better place than Winnipeg, Manitoba?
Well, okay. But let's back up just a minute and say, can you define human rights for us or talk about...
You know, I'm not an expert in human rights. I'm a corporate commercial lawyer. If you need me to draft a commercial lease for a shopping center, I'm your person. But it's like you know it when you see it. I'm a promoter of human rights because my view of what human rights is, and I'm not going to give you the definition of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. To me, human rights is being able to wear your identity freely and in peace without fear of being prosecuted. And the notion that we can be different from each other, but we can still be equal to each other and still deserving of respect. And we basically have to understand that no human being is more human than any other human being. And that's the kind of world we want to create. And that's, to me, what human rights are. And, you know, we live in very wonderful countries where those notions and those principles are respected and people fought hard. But we also know that if you don't move forward with human rights, with our freedoms, with equality, you can move backwards. And so we got to keep moving forward on these things. And as a woman, I know that, you know, what I enjoy in Canada, that I have the right to vote, that I have the right to own property, and I have the right to go to school without having acid thrown on me like girls in Afghanistan. It's really important that we appreciate our human rights, as I see them.
Hmm. Okay. Well, but let's back up to who all got involved with it? Who the people, the organizations that got involved with the museum?
Well, my dad was a phenomenal business person, and he knew that you don't have to know all the answers, but you do have to know the questions. He wanted to create this powerful, transformational experience. But he didn't know how to go about doing it. So the first thing we did was hire a phenomenal business planning firm out of Toronto called Lord Cultural Resources. They do museum planning for all around the world. They then directed us to a guy by the name of Ralph Applebaum and his company, Ralph Applebaum and Associates, out of New York. They are the premier idea museum developers in the world. Ralph did the Clinton Presidential Library. He did the Holocaust Museum in Washington. He did the Newseum in Washington on freedom of the press. He's just been hired to do the Black American History Museum in Washington. So these people said, if you want a phenomenal content, go with Ralph. Then we did an international architectural competition and hired Antoine Predock from Albuquerque, New Mexico, to develop this spectacular, and I mean crazy spectacular design. So we've got iconic architecture with Antoine Predock and a brilliant design with Ralph Applebaum. And then we have the federal government, the province of Manitoba, city of Winnipeg, 6,000 private sector donors. We've got every human rights group supporting this, from women's groups to Chinese Canadians to Amnesty International to Rotary International. So we've got, we've reached out over the last, it's been about 10 years now, we've reached out to dozens and dozens of groups, but we've got a phenomenal team making this happen.
But of course, it's referred to as the Canadian Museum for Human Rights, which may think that it's Canada you're talking about, but it's not it.
No, this is a human rights effect. This is a museum for all people, mm-hmm. anywhere in the world, because we're all human beings and human rights all matter to us. It's the Canadian Museum for Human Rights because the federal government owns it and operates it, so we're going to give them that name. And we are going to be telling for the first time Canada's human rights history and how the country got to be a democracy and respect equality. But then we move, and Canadians were very interested in this not being just a Canadian story. We did a lot of focus groups, and they said they want half of it at least to be international human rights, and most importantly, what's happening in the world today with, you know, human trafficking, child labor, what's the latest on disability rights, and where do we stand on the sort of new rights like right to shelter, health care, and so on. So it'll be something that I think will interest people wherever they're located. And of course, it'll be a very robust online presence. So you can go online anywhere around the world, tap in and see what's happening in the Human Rights Museum.
Okay. Well, and you mentioned the design, and so what will it look like when it's done? And I believe we're going to at least show a rendition here.
Well, we've got Antoine's goal was to have the museum underscore the journey. So he worked with Ralph Applebaum to say, what's your vision for the content? I want my building to support your content. He's a guy with not a big ego. He wants to make sure that it makes sense for everybody. So it begins with roots, the roots of humanity. And these are these four long tyndallstone clad roots where there's the classroom and a temporary exhibit, and actually looks like a great toboggan run. So you begin with the roots, and there's a beautiful theater with an outdoor amphitheater too, for protests and marches and whatever. Then you enter a huge the opening hallway, and then you move into the introduction to human rights. There are spectacular glass cloud that wraps the building, and actually they fold together like the doves, like wings of doves, like this international symbol of peace. So that glass is all coming from a wonderful company in Germany that's made a major donation to the museum too. We're very excited about the international support for the project. And then as you ascend through all the galleries, introduction to human rights, the Canadian story, the Holocaust, the Universal Declaration of human rights in the world today, you get to the Tower of Hope. And you go up these beautiful, as you're going, alabaster-clad ramps. Alabaster is a translucent stone that when it's backlit, it makes a glow. And Antoine Predock, the architect, wanted this to be a hopeful journey. He said, you don't want to be, jumping off the ramps because you're so depressed because it's just about atrocities. It's about heroes. It's about action. It's about hope for a better future. So you go through these alabaster-clad ramps to the Tower of Hope, and you look out on the beautiful forks of the Red and Assiniboine Rivers that have been an Aboriginal meeting ground for 6,000 years, where people come together peacefully. And so that's how you end your journey. And then you come down to the Garden of Contemplation. And this is a place where you want to talk. You don't want it quiet. You want to be talking to your neighbors about what have you seen, how is this going to affect your family, your workplace, your personal goals in life. And so hopefully you'll come away leaving transformed. If we do it right.
Okay, now you really kind of told it, but where is it located?
So this is a beautiful 6,000-year-old Aboriginal meeting ground at the forks of the Red and Assiniboine Rivers. It's a stupendous site. It's the dead center, geographic center of North America. So it's all about bridging communities. It overlooks St. Boniface, which is the largest French community outside of Quebec in Canada. It's we're talking about Aboriginal rights and Métis rights. It's down the street from where women's rights suffragette Nellie McClung fought to get women's rights in Manitoba. So it's a very special piece of land, and it was like this land was just waiting for this beautiful museum to come and take up space and welcome people from all around the world.
Hmm. I assume there will be a lot of moving stories that will be a part of this museum.
Yeah,
can you tell us about some of those?
And this is something that struck me. I couldn't believe, we have great heroes in Canada, but nobody knows about them. I don't know why. We just don't like to celebrate. And part of what gave us the idea for this museum was traveling, taking Canadian kids to Washington on a human rights trip. So we've been taking, since 1997, thousands of Canadian kids to Washington, and we go to the Holocaust Museum, and the focus is human rights. We'll go to the American History Museum and learn about Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King. Well, one example is Viola Desmond. Now, this was a diminutive 51-year-old beautician from Nova Scotia who was black in the 40s, and she wanted to sit in the main part of the theater. Black people had to sit in the balcony. She refused. She was thrown in jail, but she just stood up and got the newspapers involved, and she helped to change all the discriminatory laws against black people in Canada. Now, she did what Rosa Parks did 10 years earlier. Most Canadians have never heard of Viola Desmond. So we got to break her out of the dusty purgatory of textbooks and bring her to life in a museum with audiovisual, with arts, with people enacting stories. And that's, you know, the kind of story we'll be telling. Inspirational stories.
Inspirational indeed. You were talking about, I guess, the student travel program, but it's going to benefit students in both U.S. and Canada?
Yes, the goal is, you know, we're close to Fargo, we're close to Grand Forks, we're close to, you know, Minnesota. We want to make sure that we have kids coming from, you know, get in touch with the educators, make sure that they're, maybe we're working with them to incorporate some of the curriculum that museums got into their curriculum here, and then kids can come on all kinds of trips to visit the museum. We're actually fundraising to create an endowment fund of about $50 million that people can apply to support trips to the museum. We're going to be very proactive. We're not going to wait for people to come. We want to make sure we make it easy for people to pay for the buses or the airplanes to get here. And then it'd be great to have thousands and thousands of Canadian kids and American kids coming together and having dialogue and talking about ways that our countries can work together to make our countries better, because we're not perfect in our countries, but also the ways that our countries can work to make the world a better place.
And so this really does have an international scope to the project.
And actually, one of the great things is Rotary International, one of their pillars is human rights. So they've really gotten excited about the project. At all their international conventions, they have booths on the museum. And what they want to do is try to get one student, they're fundraising to get one student from each of their clubs, their 33,000 clubs worldwide, coming to the museum, taking part in a human rights program with maybe the universities that will develop a specialized thing for students. So yeah, it's got a very international pillar. And like I said, online, I mean, you know, Canada's a very global place. The states are very global. Everybody comes from all around the world. So what happens in Egypt, what's happening around the world really matters to us right here. What's happening in India and Pakistan. So yes, I think this is something that will be of interest no matter where you're located, which is why we've gotten donations from all around the world. I mean, we've got, you know, right off the bat, we were getting Chinese donations, Taiwan. Like I said, we've got this Italian and German companies. We've got Denmark. Israel, we've got donations from the States, actually. Raised $1 million. We have an American Friends of the Canadian Museum for Human Rights, and we raised $1 million, and we hope to raise a lot more.
Well, now, who are the Friends of the Canadian Museum of Human Rights?
Well, the Friends is the charitable arm of the museum. So the museum is now a national, federal, Canadian crown corporation. The Friends is a separate organization. It does all the fundraising. And the Friends, we incorporated the Friends basically to spearhead this thing in the few years leading up to it becoming a federal entity when we were just kind of in the wilderness. So we are, I'm the national campaign chair, and my job is to raise $150 million bucks. We're almost at $130 million and got another, you know, $20 million or so to go. But we are leaving no stone unturned all around the world, basically. And actually, the ambassadors of Canada, all the ambassadors to the Canadian government from all around the world have shown a great interest. They've held receptions for us. They're fascinated. I mean, South American ambassadors known that, you know, human rights in South America has had a rocky history, and they're fascinated by this and doing whatever they can to help us. And the French ambassador held a beautiful luncheon as a fundraiser for us in Montreal and brought in their human rights ambassador from France. So it's been great to see how this has been supported by hundreds and hundreds of different organizations and countries.
Mm. Now, you talked about the $310 million total project.
Yes.
When did you start raising money, and can you talk some about the fundraising, and then, of course, how much is left to go and how you're going to go back?
I'm so glad that you asked. Thank you. We announced this project in 2003. We announced it that and It wasn't $310 million at that time, but once we did all the analysis of what it would cost to build this stunning building, it came to $310 million. So that's when we realized we had this $150 million campaign. We started in 2003, and we've been going across Canada. We have a website that's open to everybody. And, you know, we get school groups. There's a school in Winnipeg, in Selkirk, Manitoba, just did an incredible fundraiser where they got guitars. Signed by celebrities, Bruce Willis and President Clinton, and all kinds of Jonathan Taves, hockey star, Chicago, but from Manitoba. So they signed all these guitars, and they had an auction, and they raised $50,000 for us. So it's school groups, it's millionaires and billionaires, it's pensioners writing in with a $100 check. And it, you know, we're very excited. People sometimes apologize when they can only give us $100, but we're grateful for any gift because it tells us that we're on the right path, that people, there's a demand for this around the world.
Well, and when do you expect it to be in operation?
Its planned opening is in 2013. Construction will be completed December 2012. And then we're figuring out when to have the grand opening. And we want a really big celebration because this is, you know, we started talking about this in 2000. We announced it publicly in 2003. It's been a long haul. But the good news is it is worth doing because we do believe that with Ralph Applebaum's design, we can do something that's really going to change the way people think. And if you think about, you know, say 20,000 school children coming every year on a funded trip and they go back to their parents and their communities, it was Lincoln who said, the philosophy of the classroom today will be the philosophy of the government tomorrow. So what we're teaching our kids about acceptance and respect and action and being human rights heroes is very important for the next generation. By the way, I see you're wearing your lovely human rights star pin, and that was a very important thing for my dad, that we reach for the stars. He had a worry that Canadians tend to reach for the middle, and we kind of reach for mediocrity. And, you know, we were in Washington, where it's so beautiful, and everything is so incredibly well done. And he said, when I do this for Winnipeg, it's got to be on that kind of a level. So we wear the star pin to remind ourselves that we got to reach for the stars, strive for excellence, and be a human rights star. Like, it's not up to the Bonos or the presidents or the prime ministers. It's up to ordinary people like Viola Desmond to be a human rights star. So the idea is that you wear the star and every day you remember that you're a sheriff for human rights.
Okay. Well, with that said, how can U.S. or Canadians or anybody, of course, for us, mostly it's going to be U.S. and Canadians watching this, how can they make a donation or participate?
Well, you can go to the website. I think that's probably the best thing. If you're American or Canadian, it's friendsofcmhr.com. Okay. There is a toll-free number that I hope is somehow being shown on TV here. Either way, you can. There's an American tax receipt if you're located in the States. So we have the American Friends of the Canadian Museum for Human Rights. We knew that would be very important. We have a lot of people in the States that are very passionate, and we actually have a group of volunteers in New York that are working with foundations and working with individuals who are passionate about human rights. It does really speak to everybody. And by the way, this is the largest human rights center in the world. It's the only place that really. It's not just about research. There's a lot of research centers. It's the only one that actually tries to bring the stories to life in the way that a museum can and the way that Ralph can. Not only just with plaques on the wall or data or exhibits, but through the arts, through musicians, through speeches, through enacting little vignettes, because people learn in different ways. So we have a very vibrant arts community in Winnipeg. He wants to use those actors and through visual arts and sculpture to touch people and create empathy.
Hmm. Well, let's change gears just a minute then. Let's talk about the Asper Foundation, which you're the director of.
The Asper Foundation, my dad created this foundation in 1983. He was doing very well in business, as a grateful son of immigrants who came to the country with nothing, he was always told that, you know, if you are successful in life, you have to give back. You have to leave the world a better place than the way you found it, and you just don't want to take up space in this life. And my brothers and I have two brothers, we were taught that. So he created a foundation, and he said to my brothers and me, this foundation is the fourth Asper sibling, and you are charged to look after this and make sure it grows and it goes on. And his goal was for the foundation to do transformational projects. He didn't want it to just be a check writing foundation, although, you know, we do our United Way, we do our basic things, but he wanted to do things that, but for the Asper Foundation, wouldn't happen. So the Human Rights Museum just fit him to a T. But, you know, as the president of the foundation, I'm responsible for the management of the money and making sure that we do our housekeeping and support the local hospitals and United Way and the universities and education. But human rights and the arts really have been big, big focal points for the foundation. And came through the recession very well, and it's all good.
Well, of course, your father was a great man and did many things and a lot of contributions to the area. But let's talk about the Asper School of Business in downtown Winnipeg. Can you tell us about that?
Well, yeah, the Asper School is part of the University of Manitoba. And my dad had this list of things he sort of felt that he had to kind of knock off that, as the part of the grateful student or the grateful patient with the hospitals. And the University of Manitoba was one of his great passions. He was a graduate there. He went to law school there. He actually didn't go to the business school. But he was a huge believer in supporting entrepreneurialism. You know, we have a lot of small businesses, something like 50,000 small businesses in Manitoba. And the business school always tended to skew towards large business education. He said he wanted to help them develop a school for entrepreneurship and make sure that it was strong so that, you know, it would be a place where Manitobans and people from around the world could come and learn how to, you know, create their own business and create jobs. So that's the school. He made a very major contribution to the school, and they were delighted to recognize him by giving him the name of the school. And I know it meant so much to him to go to the school and see the students and see their gratitude and see their pride.
Mm-hmm. We've talked about, of course, the museum, the foundation, but yet, what about your legal career as well?
Well, you know, I really wanted actually to be in musical theater. I love singing and acting, but honestly, my dad was starting up CanWest, his business, and it was he bet the farm and mortgaged everything to the hilt, and I figured he was probably going to go broke. And I figured, you know, even the most mediocre lawyers make a better living than the best actors or singers. You know, it's a tough life. So my dad encouraged me to go to law school, and he also said that law is a great education. Even if you never practice law a day in your life, it'll hold you in good stead. And even for the foundation, I use my law, you know, contract skills, tax skills, charitable issues. I know all that stuff, and it comes in handy. So I went to law school, and I went out to Halifax and got a great job with a wonderful small firm doing corporate and commercial law, and really thought I was going to have this illustrious law career. I thought I might end up as a judge or whatever. Then I got called back by my dad, who was getting a little older, and he said, I want you to join the family business. I need your legal skills. I want you to know how to run this business in case something happens to me. So I moved back to Winnipeg and became general counsel and corporate secretary for CanWest. Loved doing that. It was the media business, going public on the Toronto Stock Exchange, the New York Stock Exchange. Fantastic thing to be doing. But then I had to follow Dad over to the Asper Foundation when he was starting this project up. And working with my dad was just like a roller coaster ride. It was just one big adventure, but never a dull moment. And I can honestly say that every part of my life, whether it was practicing law or being in the business world or moving into philanthropy, it's been a fantastic thing. I couldn't imagine a better way to be spending my days.
Well, I also understand you're involved in arts and culture. You mentioned you do some singing and acting. Do you still like to perform?
Well, it so happens. It's all fate. The Manitoba Bar Association partnered 20 years ago with the Royal Manitoba Theatre Centre for fundraisers. And the Manitoba Theatre Centre directs lawyers, they audition lawyers, because we're all a bunch of hams, to be in a show. And so we go on stage and perform, and we sell very expensive tickets to our friends who want to come and laugh at us. So for 20 years, the Theatre Centre and the Bar Association have been doing plays. And I've been in a number of them, and we just did Gypsy, where I got to, like literally 2 weeks ago, I did Mama Rose, who is the lead pushy stage mother of all times. So it was Ethel Merman, mm-hmm. who that role was written for. And it was that was extremely challenging, but a heck of a lot of fun.
Well, recently you received two prestigious honors. Can you tell us about those?
Well, I was recognized with something very, very meaningful to me, the Order of Manitoba and then the Order of Canada, both of which are for recognizing contributions to the province or contributions to the country. And I guess I was really recognized for the Human Rights Museum and for the other work that I've done on volunteering. I do a lot of fundraising, and everybody hates fundraising, so anybody who fundraises is automatically really adored, because I thrive on rejection, I guess. But I volunteered with United Way, I chaired the campaign, chaired the board, and for the arts, I was the president of the Manitoba Theatre Centre and chaired two campaigns on the capital and endowment. And the reason I believe in the arts is, you know, I know we need our United Way, we need our bread, but the human soul needs the roses too. That's where, you know, music, you know, you couldn't, our landscape would be incredibly bleak if we didn't have the arts. So you need your healthcare, but you need the arts, and it's an essential part of what it is to be human. And and the Human Rights Museum. So I received those honors, and I'm incredibly honored and grateful, and I feel like I have to nominate other people now because I feel very guilty about all that, but very, very grateful.
Well, I'm sure very deserving. I guess really we're about to run out of time, so we want to remind folks again, if they want more information or would like to maybe even get involved with the Asper Foundation or, of course, the Human Rights Museum, where can they go?
Please contact us through the Friends website, friendsofcamhr.com. I believe it's .com, but I'm sure it's on the website somehow. We do need to raise this money. You know, reaching for the stars doesn't come cheaply, and we want to make sure we knock this out of the park. So donations are absolutely very much appreciated, and volunteers, yes, people who can come out and help us all through the website.
Well, Gail, I'm sure you'll get there. Thanks so much.
Thank you very, very much.
Well, that's all we have on Prairie Pulses this week, and as always, thanks for watching.